Again, my name is Al Hazray, Ahmed Al Hazray. I'm one of the oncologists at Florida Cancer Specialists. Florida Cancer Specialists is the largest community oncologist program out there across the state of Florida. We have multiple offices in the Central Florida region, Tavares, Leesburg, The Villages, Claremont, Orlando, and Altamont Springs. We all do community oncology, and we're all available to you, God forbid, that you would need someone like us. But what I'd like to start about talking today is about colon cancer. First, you know, we all hear about colon or the rectum, and the rectum is the latter part or the distal part of the colon. But few of us know, well, what do they do, right? What's the purpose of having a colon? What's the purpose of having a rectum? And for the most part, the primary function of your large intestines, the colon and the rectum, is to absorb water. I mean, they have a lot of other functions, but for the most part, that's the main function. That's why patients that have had part of their colon resected will quite often complain of diarrhea or loose stool because they don't have that piece that absorbs water. So this is where your body prevents itself from getting dehydrated. So speaking a little bit about the prevalence of colon cancer is the fourth most common kind of cancer in the United States, and that's staying a lot. This is a very common cancer. It's estimated about close to 140,000, 150,000 new cases each year. That's in 2013. The ratio is pretty much the same between men and women, so they both get it equally. It's the second leading cause of death. The good news is, for the most part, over the last few decades, the incidence, that's the new cases reported each year, and the number of deaths from colon cancer has been steadily declining. And we think that's ought to do to better screening, you know, the colonoscopies that we have, better education, the programs that they have to educate the populace about colon cancer, and also better drugs. And I'll show you in a second how that has improved tremendously from chemotherapy that, you know, you think of when you first hear the word chemotherapy, to targeted therapies to where you barely feel or barely know that someone is actively getting treatment for an incurable disease. So men and female equal, pretty much across the races for the most part also equal. African Americans have a little bit more chances of developing or dying of colon cancer. And there's a lot of factors to that. I'm not gonna get into the exact whys, but they just seem to have a little bit more propensity that if there was a colon cancer in such an individual, that they are more likely to die of that colon cancer. Colorectal cancer, for the most part, is a disease that we pick up early. About 80% of the time, we pick it up in limited stages. That means curable stages, whether it be a small polyp detected on a colonoscopy routine, all the way to surgery and needing chemotherapy to prevent it from coming back. So anything beyond or anything but stage 4 metastatic disease or colon cancer that has spread beyond the colon, for the most part, that's the most common scenario. 20%, on the other hand, present at the first notion with metastatic disease. And metastatic disease can be a lot of things, can be a lot of symptoms, all the way from weight loss to bloating, to bleeding, and a lot of other symptoms. But 20% of the time, I can't tell someone that they're potentially curable, but at the same time, very manageable. So even if it's not curable, it is still very manageable. Even though that it can come as early stages, obviously nothing is guaranteed in this world, so even the early stages has a chance of recurrence. And we'll see this in a second about what we mean about stages, but the higher stage you are, the more likelihood of the cancer recurrence, and therefore maybe the extra steps that you need to do to prevent that recurrence from happening. Colon cancer can present in many, many different symptoms. And I tell you that most commonly it does not have any symptoms. Most commonly it's detected on a routine colonoscopy or someone who has iron deficiency anemia and they do a routine colonoscopy and they pick up a polyp or a mass or an ulcer and they biopsy it and it turns out cancer. But when symptoms happen, most of the time it's abdominal pain, belly pain. It can be colicky, it can be stabbing, it can be intermittent. Most of the time it has nothing to do with food. It's not the kind of pain that you eat and half an hour later you have that pain. Just because if you think of it, that food has to have a lot of time, about 2-3 hours to get from the stomach down to the colon. And at the same time, by the time it gets to the colon, it's not really food in the sense that you and I know it. So abdominal pain, nausea and vomiting, especially if the colon cancer, if the colon mass has blocked off some of the intestines, so the pressure backs up to the stomach and therefore you feel nauseous. Bloating is another symptom. Changing your bowel habits, whether it be smaller caliber stools or more frequent, or changing color that's constant. Just a change in the bowel habits is very common. Patients report that very commonly. Fatigue and tiredness, especially if it's associated with anemia. All cancers cause fatigue and tiredness, but colon cancer in particular can cause particular fatigue and tiredness because of the water that it prevents from absorbing and also the risk of iron deficiency anemia. And we all know what fatigue and tiredness is. The first thing you ask is, what's my blood level? Am I anemic? Am I low on iron? Decrease in appetite. You know, someone who has been on a diet all their lives and all of a sudden start losing weight, even though they've been dieting all their lives, that's someone I want to make sure that they don't have something to worry about. Loss of appetite is very common. And it can be, for the most part, it's lost to all foods, appetite to all foods, not just particular one food or another. Someone who likes to eat a certain food and then all of a sudden doesn't want to eat that food constantly, consistently, day in, day out, well then that's something that also needs to be brought to your doctor's attention. When someone is diagnosed with cancer, and colon cancer included, the first thing I tell that person is, yes, it is cancerous, but we want to see where else it is. We want to stage this cancer. We want to figure out your risks of this cancer. And there's a lot of different ways to do that. When we talk about colon cancer, it's about the depth of invasion. So how thick, how deep did the colon cancer go into the colon wall? Not how big the colon cancer is. A colon cancer that's very big but very superficial inside the colon is a lot better or less risky than a tiny cancer that has grown deep inside the colon wall. So when they say your cancer was big, that's not what you want to hear with colon cancer. You want to hear how deep it was, not how big it was. And the deeper, the more likelihood of it presenting again and the more things that need to be done. Stage one is very superficial. These are the colon cancers that are picked up incidentally. You get a colonoscopy, they found a polyp, they take it out, they come back in a week and you tell them, yep, it was cancerous, but we got it all. You don't need to do a darn thing after that. That's stage zero, is even before cancer. It's when the changes happen, but they're not quite cancerous. It's those polyps that you remove. Stage two is that it grew a little bit into the colon wall, but hasn't involved any of the lymph nodes in the colon wall. These white things here are lymph nodes in the colon wall, and they're very important when you talk about any cancer. You want to talk about the lymph nodes also. Stage three, for the most part, is you have or someone has the cancer and it has involved one of the lymph nodes right here. And it can be this size, it can be very small, and if it involves the lymph nodes, then automatically it's a stage three. So the lymph nodes are very important when we talk about any cancer, including colon cancer. Stage four, some of us may know, is metastatic disease. It's colon cancer that has spread beyond the colon. It's involving the liver, it's involving the bone, it's involving the lung. It is still colon cancer. So a cancer that has metastasized, you might hear that word, that has spread, it's still colon cancer. It's just in the lung, in the liver, in the bone. It's treated like colon cancer. It responds like colon cancer. If you do a biopsy of it, you will see colon cancer. So if a colon cancer goes to the bone, it's not bone cancer. It's colon cancer in the bone, and it's treated like colon cancer. And that's a common misunderstanding that I get a lot with certain patients. It's, you know, they say, well, you mean I have bone cancer too? No, it's still colon cancer somewhere else. But just this is a picture just to show you that the importance of the depth rather than the size. For the most part, most cancers that are deep are also big. But really, the depth is what matters. Stage is important because it affects survivability. It affects how you treat someone, because how you treat someone is based on what kind of risks they have. A patient or a person that has very small chance of the cancer coming back, chances are you're not going to do a lot of things other than observe him, watch him, colonoscopies, scans every now and then, you know, change the diet, ask about family history, make sure their family is aware of the risks. Someone with stage three, you're going to do all that, but at the same time, because the chances of the cancer coming back are slightly higher, you might offer them chemotherapy to make sure that they bring down the risks of the cancer coming back. And chemotherapy is very effective in colon cancer. It's very well tolerated. So on one hand, you have something that works very well and at the same time has minimum to no side effects or very small amount of side effects. Well, it makes it worthwhile going through it, and it makes it worthwhile offering it. Colon cancer, that's stage one. If I can put your attention to the lower bar here, lower table. Colon cancer, that's stage one. That's a small colon cancer that has not spread to the lymph nodes or anywhere else outside of the colon, has a 5-year survival rate of about 75%. That doesn't mean that 25% die of their colon cancer. They can die of some other reasons. But at 5 years, for the most part, 75% of those folks are still alive without colon cancer. If you compare that to stage four, at 5 years, it's 5%. Now, what does that tell you? It tells you two things. It tells you that we haven't cured colon cancer that has spread beyond the colon. But at the same time, it tells you that there are folks out there that even though they have stage four uncurable colon cancer, they're still alive 5 years out of their diagnosis. And that's something certainly amazing. And that's something that certainly was even not even unheard of, or it was almost blasphemy if you say it 3 years ago. And so hopefully we're working on making that number higher and higher all the way to 100%, because we really want to have something or find a way to cure this once and for all. Patients ask me why. Why? What did I do? What did I not do? Is there something I can do right now to prevent this or to make it go away or to make it better? And for the most part, I say no. I say about 75 to 80% of the time, this is sporadic. I don't know why it happened. I might change that in the future. Science is always advancing. I might tell you 5-10 years from now that a good portion of these patients had this condition or that condition. But as of now, 80% of the time, there is nothing that that person did or didn't do or could have done. There is nothing that I can detect on genes. There's nothing that I can detect on their family history. So for the most part, it is unknown why someone would get colon cancer. 20% of the time, you can link it. You can say familial. When I say familial, I mean, I think it runs in your family, but I cannot identify the gene. I can't tell you it's this gene or that gene. It's just common sense. Your mother had colon cancer, your grandmother had colon cancer, and you have colon cancer. I guess it's safe to assume that there's something that runs in the family. Your family needs to be aware. But I can't tell them it's a specific gene. Sometimes I can, and that's genetic. And there are illnesses out there or conditions, especially familial adenomatous polyposis or hereditary non-polyposis colon cancer. These are conditions that, believe you me, if you've never heard about them, it's because it's a good reason. They're very rare. And patients who know about these diseases are usually the folks that have them, because they know from their father, from their mother, from their family members, that this illness runs in my family. And when they get to adulthood, they start worrying about this illness. So again, rarely do I tell someone it's due to this or that, but hopefully always treat it. Risk factors for colon cancer. These are risk factors for developing colon cancer. This is someone who does not have colon cancer, right? So you and I, hopefully, if we don't have colon cancer, these are the risk factors for colon cancer. Some of them you can control, and these are the ones you want to focus on. Fortunately, some of these we can't control. Everybody gets older. And once you hit the age of 50, your risk of colon cancer really shoots up. Rarely do you see colon cancer below the age of 50. After 50, it becomes very, very common. There's some racial differences. We talked about the African-American race having increased risk of developing colon cancer. Some people might attribute that to lack of healthcare access, or different diet, or genetic. We don't know that, but we do know that it's more prevalent in the African-American community. And that's why sometimes we focus our care, our screening initiatives on that community, because we know there's more incidence of colon cancer there. Dietary factors, and I can't tell you exactly what kind of food, but we all know, or we all have heard, that a high animal fat, low fiber diet can cause cancer. And if it's gonna cause cancer, if really, and I do believe this, if your diet predisposes you to cancer, well then gosh, colon cancer is gonna be the cancer that it predisposes you to. I mean, it's right there, right? The thing you're eating is in direct contact with the colon. So it would make sense that by the time your body is trying to get rid of these toxins, when as it reaches the colon, it affects the colon wall or affects the colon mucosa and causes the cancer. But I can't tell you it's, you know, chicken or beef, or I can't tell you that. We can't tell you that. Lifestyle, we know that folks who are obese, not very active, alcoholic, smokers, are increased risk of colon cancer, but I can't link that like I can link, say, lung cancer to smoking. I can't tell you that smoking causes lung cancer. I can tell you that smoking predisposes you to the lung cancer, but the link is not as strong as, say, with lung cancer. So if you take a summary of this is, well, if you are, because they're all kind of related, right? So someone who eats a low animal fat, high fiber diet and is active is likely not obese. And someone who's not obese and works out that much and puts in that much in their diet is likely not a smoker. So even though they may not be related directly, but they're related in an association, you know. Someone who's a runner is not going to be a smoker, less likely to be a smoker. Other lifestyle risk factors to increase or decrease, we talked about obesity, red meat, alcohol, and smoking to increase your risk factors. The opposite of that, you decrease your risk factors by exercising. There are reports that an aspirin daily reduces the risk of colon cancer. And these come out of folks that have a lot of polyps. Certain illnesses will have a lot of polyps in the colon that can predispose them to colon cancer. And aspirin has been shown, or that family of medicines has been shown, to reduce the risk of the polyps transforming into colon cancer. Folic acid, we think it helps. So the inside of the colon, the mucosa, is a rapidly turning over mucosa because it dies off, it sloughs off, and the body has to replace it a lot. Folic acid is very important in rebuilding cells in general, especially the fast-growing cells, blood cells. So folic acid is important in anemia, intestinal cells. Folic acid is important in regenerating intestinal cells. And we think that by taking folic acid, this is the same vitamin that's in the prenatal vitamins. Not that men should take prenatal vitamins, but it's the same vitamin that we think that can help reduce your risk of colon cancer. I think it's not one thing. I think it's a lot of things that reduces your risk of colon cancer. Because it's not just one thing that causes colon cancer. It's a lot of things that come together to cause colon cancer. So it's not, I'm going to pick one and do it and that should be enough. No, it's really a guideline, kind of like a manifesto. You don't have to do it all. You can do some of it, but the more you do, the more benefit you get out of it. And of course, calcium and vitamin D, and I know there have been reports out there that actually taking vitamin D and vitamin D can actually help make some cancers worse. And I have to say the jury's out on that. Calcium and vitamin D are very important to certain kinds of cancer, especially breast cancer. And when it comes to colon, they're less important, but they are still important. And the levels need to be monitored. So we all get a vitamin D level at least once a year. And that level needs to be at least normal. Screening is really the most important thing because it's an instantaneous thing. It gives you the results right away. And not only that, but the method of screening can be the method of treatment at the same time. So screening is very, very important. And we think that's really why the rates of colon cancer have decreased over the years instead of increasing, even though our diet has only gotten worse and our obesity has only gotten worse. So colon cancer in general, and I'll use colon cancer as an example, it does not start from nothing. So a cell does not go from normal, healthy cell to cancer without going through certain stages or certain phases of its life. It goes from a normal cell to a dividing cell to an abnormal looking cell, to a really abnormal looking normal cell, to a cancerous cell that's very low grade, to a cancerous cell that's more active, and then cancer develops. So these phases, you have time, we have time to pick it up and prevent. So you might have a colonoscopy and the doctor comes out and says, well, we picked a polyp that was precancerous. What he means is there's no cancer in there, but given enough time and the right circumstances, those cells would have turned into cancer. So for the most part, colon cancer does start as a polyp, commonly. And at the age of 50, you have about a 25% chance of having a polyp. Not cancer, a polyp. And so these are common. One in four of us by the age of 50 will have a polyp. That number goes up by a lot. If you can read with me, it's 50 to 75% will have a polyp at the age of 75. Now, I'm not saying these are all gonna be cancerous, but if it was me, I would wanna make sure that those polyps are out before they develop into cancer. Because a small thing on the left, like this thing, that can be easily removed with a snare. That's a snare. They kind of put it around the neck of the polyp and they just snare it out. This small thing can develop into this awful looking thing, colon cancer, within a matter of years. So it's very important and it's very easy to do a colonoscopy and remove that polyp. And if you take anything from me today, is I don't want to see colon cancer. I would love to treat it. I'd love to take care of people with colon cancer, but I would rather have nobody have colon cancer. And the best way to prevent that is to actually do colonoscopies and remove polyps and remove abnormal cells before they even fester into colon cancer. I get these questions a lot. What's the relationship between blood sugar and cancer? Well, they actually tested that. So folks who have had colon cancer removed, they've had their treatment of chemotherapy, and they're diabetic. The folks that have had their sugars better controlled, their weight better controlled, so body mass index, BMI, is a function of weight. It's just another way of saying how, you know, what's your weight. The higher the BMI, the heavier someone is. So someone who's had colon cancer and has watched their weight, has watched their blood sugars, has watched their blood pressure, and their weight has not fluctuated, has not increased or decreased, has not increased, let's put it that way. At 5 years, so imagine a line right here. Imagine a line right here. This is change in sugar control. So at 5 years, if you have your sugars and your weight better controlled, less than one, or less than, changes are not that much, then your risk of the colon cancer coming back is actually about less than 10%, or sorry, less by 10%. Compare that to if your sugars, your weight, is out of control at 5 years. Your risk goes up by 2.2-fold. So you have twice as much chance of developing colon cancer or returning the colon cancer if your weight and your sugars are not under control. Now, that does not mean that if you eat sugar, you will develop colon cancer, or that if you have colon cancer and you eat something sugary, you will fuel it, because that's not what I'm saying. Most of us don't have diabetes. Most of us, if we eat sugar, our blood sugar will not change that much. Or if it does change, it only changes for a few minutes or half an hour because we have insulin. But I'm saying over the long run, these are lifestyle changes. This is not something you do today. This is something you do today, and you keep on doing it for years and years and years. They looked at diet, and we all hear about the Western diet, and you can define the Western diet as well or as undefined as you want, but it's mostly low fiber, high meat. And they compared it to a prudent diet, high fiber, low meat, a lot of veggies, a lot of fruits. And they also compared them for a long time. And they asked the same question, disease-free survival, DFS. So disease-free survival is how much time did you have without having the disease? So how much time does someone live without having their cancer come back? Free of disease, free survival, disease-free. And folks who ate a Western diet compared to folks who didn't eat the Western diet, the folks who ate the Western diet had almost a four-fold increase of the cancer coming back. So that just tells you that I can't tell you which one in our diet, in our Western diet, I can't tell you what exactly makes the cancer come back. I can't tell you if it's the diet or the thing that we do with the diet. Is it because we're not as active if we eat our diet? Is it because we get heart disease and that might affect the colon cancer? I can't tell you that. This graph does not tell you that. It just tells you that if you eat a Western diet and you don't watch what you're eating, you're at increased risk of developing the colon cancer returning. Again, these are folks that already have had colon cancer and they're asking me, what can I do to prevent it from coming back? I say the most important thing is what you put in your mouth. You control your diet, you control your sugars, you control your blood pressure, and you control your weight. That's the most important thing you can do. It's not taking a supplement. It's not taking folic acid. That's important. But you really want to bring it down? This is what you do. And it's the hardest. You know, it's easy to take a vitamin, it's easy to take a supplement. The hard part is changing our habits. They also asked diabetics. They said, okay, so what happens if diabetics lose control of their diabetes? And as you can tell from the graph, the more loss of control, the increased risk of the cancer coming back. So for us diabetics out there, if you have colon cancer or you had colon cancer, you better control your sugar, you better control your weight, you better control your diet, or else the risk is higher. And I always tell folks, you just went through surgery and chemotherapy and the hassle and the time spent in the family turmoil. The last thing you want to do is not do something, right, that prevents you from coming here again. The last thing you want to do is just throw all that away and not abide by these common relatively easy to do clear, not easy, I should say, not easy, but clear things. And so, you know, getting chemotherapy is easy. Changing the way you eat is not, to be honest. And we all have been there. We've all used diet supplements. We've all used, you know, gizmos and things we saw on TV, but really it's about changing the lifestyle. So again, colon cancer doesn't start from null. Usually it's precancerous that starts first. For most of us, if we have a polyp or an adenoma, and that's a precancerous polyp, it takes about 8 to 10 years to develop into cancer. Some illnesses, such as the HNPCC, and that stands for hereditary non-polyposis colon cancer, that's a familial illness, a genetic illness. Folks have it, they know they have it, they can test for it, it's a gene on the blood test. They develop adenoma to cancer in 2 to 3 years. So someone who doesn't have that disease doesn't need a colonoscopy every year. Needs a colonoscopy every 5 to 10 years, because it takes that long to get from A to B. Someone who has that disease, that genetic disease, needs a colonoscopy almost every year, because it takes a lot shorter for a polyp to go from a benign precancerous polyp all the way to cancer. So the method or the frequency of colonoscopy has a lot to do with your risk. So the person who's doing your colonoscopy is going to ask about, well, your family history. Have you had any polyps before? They're not asking you those questions just to put on a piece of paper. They're asking you those questions to quantify your risk and figure out how often do you need to have a colonoscopy? How much colonoscopy can you get away with a minimum colonoscopy? Do you need a full-blown colonoscopy? Do you need extra testing done? So a lot of what we do depends on the risk that we're faced with. Now, screening is the most important thing to prevent. You know, if you prevent the polyp by removing it, you decrease the incidence of colon cancer. If you decrease the incidence of colon cancer and you early detect it, you lessen the amount of death from colon cancer. Simple mathematics. So if we as a society wants to eliminate colon cancer, we better do a better job doing a colonoscopy. And you all know people that don't want to do a colonoscopy. And I would rather you be irritating to them about getting a colonoscopy, right? And saving their lives, you know, rather than saying, okay, fine. You know, don't give up on the person that doesn't want to do a colonoscopy. Bug them. Usually works. Screening methods are plenty, and we have a lot of different ways to screen for colon cancer. The best way remains a colonoscopy because it visualizes the inside of the colon, the entire colon, from the anal verge, the rectum, all the way to the small intestines. But there's a lot of things that the doctors might do to supplement that. So a occult test to test for blood in the stool. They usually do one or two in a row. A mini colonoscopy or a sigmoidoscopy. And that's usually if someone has, let's say, has had colon cancer and their colon is short, or they're having symptoms that you think is in the lower part of the sigmoid part of the colon. It doesn't substitute from a colonoscopy, but it helps make the colonoscopy, the full one, maybe less often. Colonoscopy every 10 years is usually the gold standard. Depending on what kind of society you follow, you might recommend every 5 to 10 years. But a colonoscopy, you know, based on your risk, it can be 5 to 10 years. It can be shorter than that. Going back to staging, and just to give you an idea of how we treat things, if someone has no lymph node involvement, meaning a stage one or a stage two, I probably would offer them only surgery, whether it be removal of the polyp and that's surgery, or having actually part of the colon removed and that's surgery. In rectal cancer, it's a bit different because even though there might not be that much lymph node involvement, because of the place of the rectum, surrounded by a lot of vital organs or a lot of organs around it, and no clear planes for the surgeon to go in and remove the rectum, they might need some radiation or chemotherapy before or after the surgery. When there's lymph node involvement or there's spread of the colon cancer somewhere else, the risks become higher, and for the most part, we offer chemotherapy plus minus radiation. So some definitions, and you'll hear doctors talk about this. You know, chemotherapy, as we all know, are chemicals, but not all chemicals are created equally. You know, some chemicals are very easy on the body. They typically will include a medication called 5-FU or 5-fluorouracil. You'll see a lot of colon cancer treatments that include that. Consider it the backbone of most colon cancer treatments. And a lot of other medicines are added or subtracted from that based on that person. So it's really personalized treatments and personalized care. Combinations are usually work better than one drug at a time. The types of chemotherapy, and these are definitions that just to make you familiar with, there's adjuvant chemotherapy, and that's usually given after you've gotten rid of the cancer. Right? So someone comes to me, they've had surgery, they removed the cancer. There is no evidence of cancer in their body. But the risk of it coming back justify treatment. That treatment is called adjuvant. There's neoadjuvant, and that basically says I'm giving him or her treatment before they've had surgery to shrink the cancer, to make the surgery easier. If someone has a big tumor and the surgery is going to be a big surgery, to have to remove a lot of things, well, why not give him chemotherapy to shrink that tumor and the surgery will be easier? It won't substitute from the surgery, but it'll make the surgical outcomes a lot better. And that's very important, especially with rectal cancers, because a lot of times you can save somebody from getting a bag, like a colostomy bag. Palliative chemotherapy, and that's usually for metastatic disease, and so the goal of that therapy is not to cure the cancer. If it does, great, because it has done that before. But the goal of that therapy is to alleviate the suffering, prolong life, and improve quality of life. And some folks do look me in the eye and they say, I don't want it. And I can't, you know, I try to explain the rationale. I never, you know, suggest that they have to have it. But some folks just don't want it, even though I guarantee them, or I almost guarantee them, that the side effects are worthwhile. And that's why it's a personal option. And that's why I always tell folks, don't make any decisions until you hear everything out. Chemotherapy is like any other medicine, guys. You take one dose. If you don't like the chemotherapy, if you don't like the way you feel on chemotherapy, then don't do it again, unless you want to do it again. Just like taking an antibiotic, you take it 2-3 days, you get a lot of diarrhea, you're going to call your doctor and say, I'm not going to take this anymore. He's probably going to give you something else. Same thing. If we do one dose or two doses and side effects are more than what you and I accept, then we have to change, whether it be stopping it or changing to something else. Radiation therapy is sometimes used in colon cancer, and for the most part, it's for rectum cancer. And there's a lot of different ways to do it. Here at Florida Hospital Waterman, we do the external beam, and that's a machine that sits outside your body. But there are radiation methods that give radiation intraoperatively while they're doing the operation, although that has never been really the standard of care, but certainly is out there. And usually, like I said, it's for rectal cancer either before or after the surgery. So I want to use stage 4 metastatic colon cancer to talk about the kinds of chemotherapies and the side effects, because for the most part, the chemotherapy I use for stage 4 is for the most part very similar to the chemotherapy I use for, you know, the stages earlier than that. The only difference is what you expect out of them, what the goal of treatment is. So I get this question a lot. I have colon cancer. It's stage 4. Doc, you told me it's not curable. Why can't we go in and remove it? Why can't we go in and take it all out? And the simple answer, and not really a simple answer, is because, well, for the most part, even if you do, it does not change. In fact, it can actually harm. It does not change your status. It doesn't change what you have to do. It doesn't change your longevity. It doesn't change the things you have to do in terms of treatment. In fact, it might delay those and therefore harm you. So when they took about 233 patients and they asked doctors, what did you do? Did you take out the colon cancer? So these are colon cancer patients with a colon mass and spots of colon cancer somewhere else. And they asked the doctors, well, what did you do? Did you recommend that you take out the colon mass? Did you think that that was beneficial to your patient? 89% of the time they said, no, I did not do that because it's not worth it. They didn't do anything at all. 11% actually did. And for the most part, it's because they have symptoms. And when I say they did something, it can be they resected it, they removed it, or they bypassed it. You hear of gastric bypass, where there's a colon bypass. It's basically going around the obstruction, getting symptom relief. They did an ostomy, or that's the bag, to relieve the obstruction, to lift the cancer in there, but they did an ostomy. Or they put a stent. They're not very good, but they help achieve resolution of symptoms. Or they did some radiation therapy to shrink the cancer. So for the most part, we do not remove the primary tumor because it delays your treatment and it doesn't change what you and I are going to do in the future. Now you hear about personalizing care, meaning why would someone get one thing and another person get another? And that's because, well, the colon cancer, I'm not gonna say that even, the colon cancer is different. Not all cancers are the same. Not even all colon cancers are the same. You might have a twin and they have colon cancer and the colon cancer might be different than yours. It might not be different the way it looks underneath a microscope, but it's different in its genes, it's different in its behavior, and therefore it's different in what you need to do about it. But also, people are different. So someone who has colon cancer that is only in the colon, you're gonna do something different than if it has colon cancer in the lungs and bones, or 10 spots, or one spot, or 100 spots. So I can't convince you, or I shouldn't be able to convince you, that what I do for someone who has very minimum disease is the same thing I do for someone who has a lot of disease. And it shouldn't be the same. People are different in age. People are different in the things they can do. That's the performance status. One of the few questions I ask, or one of the, not few, but the many questions I ask is, well, tell me, what can you do? You know, tell me about your day. And I'm not asking about, you know, I don't want to know what they're watching on TV or anything like that, but I want to know, can they climb a flight of stairs? Are they able to cook and clean for themselves? Can you dress yourself? Are you doing your own shopping? Are you driving? And that's called performance status. I want to know how much exertion, how much stress you put your body through, and it lets you get by with it. And that tells me how much intensity treatment I can do, and at the same time, get away with it, or us getting away with it. What kind of illnesses do they have? Someone who has heart disease, as you'll see in a few minutes, someone who has heart disease, they can't do certain medications. Someone who has a lot of diabetes, they can't do other medications. Someone who has, you know, IBS with irritable bowel, they can't do other kinds of medications. So how we treat someone is vastly different than how we treat another. Organ function, and that might be related to age. You know, I've had patients who've had heart transplants with colon cancer. What do I do then? I don't want to, you know, damage the heart. I have patients with bone marrow transplants. They, you know, at a young age, they had a bone marrow transplant. They got radiation to their body, and we think that's why they developed colon cancer. But here they are, they age, you know, 55, and we have to deal with colon cancer now, and we have to be careful of something they did, you know, 20, 30, 40 years ago. Convenience. Someone who lives very far, I can't bring him in every day. Someone who lives very close, I might be able to bring him in every other day or every day, depending on the side effects. Cost, and this is a huge thing, and we all know how our healthcare is changing. Someone who can get something cheaper and does the same thing, well, you're gonna use that, common sense. Someone who can afford or their insurance will approve something that might add a tiny bit of improvement, well, you'll go for that. It might not be that tiny bit of improvement, might not be worth to the other person who has to pay out of their pocket for that, who can't afford that. And God only knows our tools are very expensive. So we take great pride in making sure that we are as cost effective, not necessarily cheap, but cost effective as possible. And of course, patient prevalences. On the left here, these are common regimens we use in colon cancer. God knows that if I had not done this for the last 5 to 6 years, I would not know what these things are. So I don't expect you to. But these are acronyms to the drugs we use with colon cancer. I don't want you focusing on that. I want you focusing on this arrow and how it's going, like stepwise, getting longer and longer. And this is months. So back in the day when we had no chemotherapy, someone with colon cancer that's stage 4, they had an average lifetime expectancy of 4 to 6 months. It's awful. 4 to 6 months is tomorrow. 4 to 6 months, absolutely. And then came 5-FU. And it went from 4 to 6 months to 12 to 14 months. That's still not great, but it more than doubled. And as we add more chemotherapy or better chemotherapy, nowadays I can really look somebody in the eye and say, well, yeah, the average, doesn't mean you. If you open up a book, the average with stage 4 colon cancer is 2 years, meaning a lot of people live more than that. So why not you? With treatment, it doesn't have to be 2 years of treatment. But so that's why I say it's a very manageable disease, because for the most part, and as we progress, this number is getting longer and longer. I have folks 3-4 years out of their chemotherapy first time for stage 4 colon cancer. Of course, I have other folks that don't make it that long, but averages are for the books. When you talk to someone face to face, it's really about that person. Again, crowded slide, but I want you to focus on the top bar. When you hear of chemotherapy, here's what you think of. You think of nausea, vomiting, lose my hair, I'm gonna be sick all day, hugging the toilet, I'm not gonna be out of bed. Well, here's the most common kinds of side effects with chemotherapy used with colon cancer. Neutropenia, which is low blood counts, not severe, but low blood counts. Diarrhea, almost, you know, it can get up to 20%. Again, not severe, diarrhea, Imodium usually helps. Remember, some of these folks have already had their colon removed, so they're kind of prone to diarrhea. Neurosensory, and we'll talk about this in a second. One of the most common drugs we use causes a lot of numbness and tingling in the fingertips and toes. Again, doesn't have to be severe, but numbness. And hand and foot syndrome. It's where your palms and soles of the feet become red and tender. You stop your medicine, it gets better. So I don't see nausea, vomiting. I don't see hair loss. And for the most part, I don't see a lot of fatigue and tiredness, although it does cause that, but nothing like you and I think of when I hear the word chemotherapy. That's because of biologics, targeted therapies. You hear all this buzz about targeted therapy. It's a chemotherapy that only attacks the cancer. Well, kind of, but not really. It attacks the cancer in a smart way, to where your body can just get that cancer or get that chemotherapy and just throw it out and not be affected by it, where the cancer can't do that. So it's a sneaky way, not really a smart way, a sneaky way of killing the cancer. And that's because of, we know what makes the cancer tick. Crowded slide again, but this is a cell membrane. These are the cancer cells. This is the outside of the cancer cell. This is the inside of the cancer cells. What makes the cancer tick is factors, like growth factors, like steroids for the cancer. And we found out that there are multiple factors or proteins that you and I make all the time that the cancer uses to promote its growth. And one of these factors is something called VEGF, or vascular endothelial growth factor. Why is that important? Because bevacizumab, or Avastin, is a medication that's approved to combat that particular growth factor. And it's very well tolerated. The most common side effect is a little bit of fatigue. The most serious side effect can be wound complications, so somebody should not take it if they have, if they just went through surgery. Because when you, so this is the focus on this one. So when you have a cut, your blood vessels rush in and cells rush in to fill in that cut, to fill in that wound. Well, this is a medicine that prevents growth of blood vessels. So it wouldn't make sense that if you have a wound that needs blood vessels to grow through, and you give a medicine that prevents the growth of blood vessels, well, then that wound is not going to heal as well as it should. So someone who's getting surgery should not get this medicine 8 weeks before and 8 weeks after. These medicines, they don't cause the typical side effects. They cause blood clots in about 2% of the time. That's why when you're on them, it's preferred that if you have a history of blood clots that you take an aspirin a day. They can cause bleeding. So it causes blood clot and it causes bleeding. That's because of the way it works on the blood vessels. Because in order to have a wound that doesn't bleed, you have to have growth of new blood vessels. If you don't have that, you can increase your bleeding. It can cause high blood pressure. What kind of chemotherapy causes your blood pressure to go up? This is the kind. Doesn't cause hair loss, doesn't cause nausea and vomiting, doesn't cause all these horrible side effects, but it does cause high blood pressure. It can make you lose protein in the urine. We don't know what that means. We don't know if it's important. But sometimes if it's really, 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 really bad, you lose some nutrients from the body. So we monitor that. It can cause perforation of your intestine because it works so good that if there's a cancer cell in the colon wall and you kill it off, it leaves a hole in its place. And that can cause some infection in the abdomen. So gastrointestinal perforation, holes in the walls in the intestines. But all these things are less than 5%. Very rare. Serious, but very rare. So very well-tolerated medicine. There's another medicine. There's another pathway. I'm not going to stop talking about medicines in particular because it's really pathways. So molecules that affect a certain door that leads to the cancer. So this door is called the EGFR, or the epidermal growth factor receptor. And again, the cancer uses this door to promote itself, to grow, to spread, and there are medicines that target it. So this is a medicine, this is a protein medicine that binds to this molecule and shuts off the factory inside. And the factory is responsible for growth of the cancer. And these class of medicines, the most common side effect is a rash. It's like being 18, acne, but not really 18. You don't feel 18. And the best thing to do is an antibiotic. You take an antibiotic once or twice a day, it prevents it from happening. It prevents the rash from happening. It prevents the other side effects of the medicine from happening. The low magnesium. Notice I didn't say nausea or hair loss or fatigue or tiredness. Rash. I mean, how bad can a rash can be? It can be pretty bad, but still not nausea and vomiting. And so if you do this antibiotic, if you do this moisturizer that, you know, all you ladies use, you can prevent that rash from happening, you can make it less severe, and therefore you get the benefit of the medicine without actually going through the side effects of the medicine. We talked about a little bit of numbness, and it can be a pretty devastating thing if you push the envelope. That's why every time I see someone on this medicine, hey, show me your button in your shirt. Show me that you can button your shirt. Show me that you can zip your zipper for the guys. Show me that you can flip a page. Write your name for me. Handwriting, because of numbness. Someone who has a lot of numbness can't hold the page, can't button their shirt, can't up their zipper, can't write their name legibly. So that's something that we always monitor. So neuropathy, numbness. And for the most part, if you stop the medicine, so by stopping the medicine, it will fade away. And it can take up to 2 to 3 years for it to completely fade away. Some folks, it never fades away. At 4 years, there's still a lot of people, or a good 10% of the people, that still have numbness and tingling, especially if they're diabetic. They already have a little bit of numbness and tingling in their fingertips and toes. And I have to say, this is the most important side effect of these class of medicines, because this is the one that lasts the longest. This is the one I hear about 2, 3 years after. And so I make darn sure that while they're getting their medicine, that this doesn't get out of hand. And there's things you can do like vitamin B6 and glutamine, you know, from the GNC store, from the health food store to prevent this from happening. Some doctors still to this day will do calcium and magnesium before or after chemotherapy. We know for a fact that that does not work. Some patients that I used to do it on folks 2 or 3 years ago, we know for a fact that that does not work. It actually sometimes makes the cancer worse. So what I want to tell you is that we think we know it, but we always, always make sure that we know it. So we always look for something better. We always fine-tune our medicines. Even though we think what we're doing is good, we always reevaluate it. And so what you get now does not necessarily mean the same thing you're going to get if you had the same disease a year or two from now. So we talked about genetics a little bit. Cancer genetics is what drives cancer, right? The DNA of something is how you identify something. And when it comes to colon cancers, there's 2 or 3 DNA molecules that you want to know about. If I am a cancer patient with colon cancer, I want to know what my KRAS is. It's a molecule in the genes of the cancer, not necessarily in my body. Because if I know what that is, I know what I can get, what this cancer will be responsive to. There's other molecules down in that list that are also important. But I'll try to explain this slide. If the KRAS, and that's the DNA molecule that we talked about, was positive, so it was mutant, then the folks that got this medicine, this panitumumab, and that's an EGFR medicine, it's a colon cancer medicine, the folks that got this medicine did the same thing as if they did not get that medicine. You can almost see these two lines are identical. You want to see separation between the lines to say if something is better or not. So folks who got this medicine and had the KRAS mutant, bunch of side effects for nothing. Folks who got that medicine and the KRAS was not mutant, was not abnormal in the colon cancer, they actually did better. So if I can sit here and tell you, well, because of your DNA in the cancer cells, you're responsive to this, this, or that, and we can't use these because you're not going to be responsive to them. Because remember, if I give you those medicines, even though you're not responsive, you're still going to get the side effects and waste the time. That's personalized care. It's personalized care because you skipped through things that you know are not going to work for you. They might work for somebody else. So in summary, colon cancer is common, actually very common. Most are early stage, so having colon cancer 80% of the time, you and I are going to be best buds because 80% of the time it's curable. It is effectively curable, and you may need chemotherapy to prevent it from coming back depending on the stage. Diet and well-being are important. I use the word well-being because you can translate it into whatever you want, whether it be diet, exercise, folic acid, calcium, aspirin. Cancer genetics are very important. Nowadays, if I get a new patient with cancer, for the most part, all cancers, but especially colon cancer, I will run a genetic profile on that cancer, 10, 20 genes. I will know what that cancer uses to grow. And therefore, not only now, but 3, 6, 12, 24 months from now, what that cancer will be susceptible to, and kind of have a plan of what to move from A to B to C a lot smoother than say, well, let's see what this, let's try this. Hopefully the era of let's try this and see is slowly but surely declining. And I would consider it a chronic disease. A lot of folks have colon cancer that is uncurable, but they're living their lives to the fullest. You can barely tell that they're getting colon cancer treatment, and for the most part, are very active in their community. Thank you. Thank you for having me again.